Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Very warm welcome yet to another sitting at the coffee table. Kashmir is simmering once again for the past many days. Many have been killed, people have been blinded with, you know, pellet shots and a lot of brutalities. India has literally unleashed a regime which is unprecedented. Obviously, it's a indigenous struggle. But what to say, that whenever it starts, there's a, some sort of skirmishes and bad temper that prevails on both sides of the border between India and Pakistan. And the border is hot right now. Many people have been, there have been casualties in Bhimber and elsewhere. And now the world looks at the area as a, not only as a simmering point, but as a nuclear flashpoint. What is the solution of this Kashmir problem? People say that Pakistan and India are Siamese twin, joint at the back, and that is Kashmir. Unless surgically they are separated, they cannot turn back and have a bear hug, and there can be no friendship. We have today with us Ms. Farzana Yaqoob, who is a politician, and she was minister in Kashmir in the last regime. And her father was the president of Azad Jammu and Kashmir, the Pakistani administered part of the Kashmir. And she's very much involved in the politics in Azad Kashmir and on the other side of what goes on the other side. She has a, she keeps a very close eye, has a contact with the politicians. And at the intellectual level, she has been doing struggle for the past many years now. Ms. Farzana Yaqoob, very warm welcome.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
How would you state your case? What is the generic of it? I mean, what is the basic premise?
I think at this point of time, whatever is going on in the Indian occupied Kashmir is the indigenous people who are Kashmiris, and let's not separate them. In the lines of religion, they have stood up against the hegemony of the Indian government, and they are trying to express their anger, their humiliation, their embarrassment that they have suffered for a very long time. And no matter what India tries to do, they are unable to handle this situation in such a manner that the people are satisfied enough to go back into their homes. They are unable to do this. The more people that they kill, the more people come out on the streets, and they have never been faced with such reaction. What has always been a major weapon of the Indian government and their army was to scare people, to maim them into submission. That is not working this time. 80 plus days of retaliation, constant retaliation, and all these Kashmiri people have are their tongues with which they chant slogans and stones in their hands. And how are they dealt with? Pellet guns and different other ammunition, and then they're stalked, and then they're being followed, and then they're being heard, and they're being followed on the social media as well. So India is unable to curtail this situation. I mean, 700,000 plus forces, and at this point of time, because of the increased escalation and the situation that it is at this point of time, it is 800,000 plus forces in Indian occupied Kashmir. If it were such a peaceful and integral part of India, why do they need to have
such a large
contingent, part of their forces to be residing over there? And these forces are not in the bunkers. Mind it, they're on the roads. They're everywhere. You will see more of the forces than Kashmiris themselves.
Do you think still they want to join into Pakistan? They just want Azadi from India?
At this point of time, I think let's not mix it up with the different emotions. What the Kashmiris want is Azadi from India. Once that level is reached, then they can, you know, decide where and what they want to do.
Level of militancy or unrest, you're saying? Or the emotional...
Look, I will never call my Kashmiris as militants.
No, no, but you know, Burhan Wani's father in an interview said that we started in 1947 and they have brought us to AK-47.
Yeah, that's what he said. He did not say that we are militants. We are fighting for our just right.
Right. But
We are freedom fighters.
Up
but
in arms.
We are not... Well, there is a very small section of people who might have these ammunitions, but most of the people, most of the photos that you are getting are seeing on the social media are of men and women and children with pellets, with stones, who are throwing stones, and what they are receiving are pellet injuries. Most of them have gone blind. They are blinding our youth. And that is a very difficult situation to be in. And also the fact that it is the youth which has risen up. This is educated class of Kashmir. They were in universities, they were in colleges, and Burhan himself was a very talented young man. But what he went through, he became what he became. And that is what now people aspire to be. That is what young boys and girls are aspiring to be. Like, it is better to die than to live in these conditions.
Right.
So it's become, when a nation or a human population reaches this level, then the world needs to recognize that they are going through some kind of issues. They are facing extreme difficulties for them to come up and come out like this. You cannot ignore them. This is something that cannot be ignored. And so slowly and steadily, the international media has taken it up. Pakistani media is starting to give it some time, because now this cannot be ignored. If a Syrian child's death is hailed as a very negative sign of the peace making processes of the world, well, then so is the death of a Kashmiri child. It is a complete failure at the end of these peacemaking bodies who have been brushing the issue of Kashmir under different carpets for all this time. But now what they have done is that they have spoken. They have not done anything. There is no action that which is following these words, but they are starting to speak about it. And for us, that
international community,
of course,
yeah.
At least they have started, when they speak, that means there is some acknowledgement. Okay, there is something wrong. And that acknowledgement was also not there. So although it is painful and extremely sad, the state that we are in, but at least now the world knows that this is nothing less than Palestine.
But India is trying to involve Pakistan.
India has always done that.
Why?
India is a master of involving Pakistan, because India is the divorced spouse who cannot get over the one who divorced it. So this separation has never gone down with India very well. And so always anything and everything that happens within India is always pointed towards Pakistan.
But do you think, technically speaking, India is going to get some advantage on Kashmir issue by involving Pakistan?
I don't know. It all depends how Pakistan takes it out.
For example, this morning, they are firing, but not on the line of control, but on the working body.
Yes. But that's where India expresses its grief on Kashmir. Be it on within Azad Kashmir, or be it the Kashmiris within India. Afzal Guru was a Kashmiri. The students who were kicked out for celebrating Pakistan's win in an Indian university were Kashmiris. Kashmiris are always meted out punishment for expressing themselves and feeling happy about Pakistan. And you know, they've cornered Kashmiris to such a level that the you will see flags of Pakistan.
Yeah, every day.
Although they are chanting Azadi and they might not be saying the name, but the flags are there. You cannot ignore them.
And they, you know, they are burying their dead with the Pakistani flag wrapped around it.
Yes.
Burhanwani.
Yes. Because we the Kashmiris think that this is a proper, official, respectful way of putting our shohada, giving them a respectful burial.
So, what is the stage now? How would you define it? It's close to precipice, or the tipping point has come, or it will linger on, or once again, it will just, it would be an ebb and flow, and it will go down again for another 10 years.
80 days is quite a long time. It's more than 2 months. We're reaching the third month. When this happened in the 80s and 90s, it took years for it to go down. But at that time, since the media was not so proactive, and it was very difficult to actually get any kind of news anywhere, so we sort of got lost in history. I don't see that happening now.
No.
You can't ignore it. It is so in the face. People are standing up for it. Now, to say that what India and Pakistan do, I cannot say much about it. But what Kashmiris have said to date is that they will not now give up.
They will not.
They have never given up.
You don't have any
Since 1947, they have never given up.
In Pakistan, in Pakistan, the Congress party was Kashmiri itself, the Kashmiri party it was, and they occupied the Kashmir. Right now, there's a Kashmiri party in Pakistan, Nawaz Sharif, or Defense Minister, Khwaja Asif, Saad Rafiq, Parvez Rashid, all the Kashmiris are at the helm of affairs. So do you pin some hope on them? Or do you take it?
The thing is that at that level, when you're in the governance and at the helm of affairs, it's a very different world to be in. When you're talking to state heads, be it United Nations or you're visiting their countries, this country has, as far as I remember, never had a leader like firebrand Modi, a dumb, extremely nonsensical person. The only other person that is who equals Modi in his nonsense is Trump in America.
Trump.
Yes, of course. So we do not have such people that will talk stupidly, no matter how and whatever might be the issues with the different political parties of Pakistan. But we have to say this fairly, that you know, Kashmir has never been ignored in any of the communiques with any of the, be it United Nations, be it OIC, or wherever the meetings happen of international bodies coming together. Pakistan has never said that, okay, we can leave Kashmir and move forward. Even when Pakistan wants to have CBMs or any kind of meeting, they place Kashmir as an agenda item, and that is why then India will either postpone it or they will come up with a lame excuse of not holding those meetings. For India, Kashmir is not an agenda item. For Pakistan, it always is. Although at a local level, we've seen that there has been a pressure that, okay, you know, you can sort of keep it on the sidelines, but we need to be more friends, and you know, we need to increase trade, and we need to do this and that. And but time and again, India has shown its true face. No matter how friendly a hand you deal with them, they will deal the Indian hand. You can't ignore it.
So here we take a break, and after the break we'll try to further analyze the situation. Please stay with us.
It's diverse.
It's original.
It's SDTV.
Welcome back. Where we go from here?
There's
what do you see happening in over the next few weeks?
I think more news of Kashmiri agitation will come out, because remember, every Friday is an agitation day for us Kashmiris, and Kashmiris have not been allowed to perform their prayers. This was the first time we were not allowed to perform Eid prayers. So this is at a very grave point that the whole area is. And the attitude of Indian government and their army is not such that anyone would even want to sit on the table and talk to them.
Right.
The level of their inability to deal a soft hand or to invite the people to talk to is just phenomenal. They do not want to talk to anyone. They do not want to discuss anything other than which they think should be discussed. That is not how you have discussions and debates. All the sides need to vent their emotions. They need to sit and talk about
it. But do you think for the first time in the last 70 years, there's a tremendous support for Kashmiris inside India?
Yes, of course.
Which was not there earlier.
Yes, of course. I mean, you see, that is where the social media and everything really comes up. And that is the difference this time. The local Indian support, particularly, I must say, the people from there, the artists of India have really stood up. And I think that started
intellectuals
because of
even.
Arundhati Roy.
Yeah.
I think, you know, basically, you know, this, the traction increased because of people like her speaking up, being brave enough to tell about their country, that, you know, this is India, but this is what they are doing. And she has always been extremely vocal about Kashmir.
But this time what she has said is very interesting. She said, for the Kashmir solution is Azadi.
Of course.
And the India want Azadi from Kashmir more than the Kashmir Azadi from India.
Yes.
She said that. And which is a
they need to recognize this fact. I mean, even for India, Kashmir is becoming a very expensive child.
Right.
But it's become an issue of ego, most probably, because they're not ready to let go. Both of them. India is extremely egoistic. And also, water is a major issue for Pakistan. But remember,
and India as well.
Of course, but Pakistan has one water basin, the Indus. India has more than one. India has been working on water. Their storage is 90 days. Pakistan is 9 days. So Pakistan's desperation when it comes to water is way more than Indian, because they have been working on their waterways. They're not just sharing waters with Pakistan. It's the same with Bangladesh. They have and they have their turf wars with other countries as well. You see, India is not just
China.
India is not just isolated with Pakistan. India does not get along with any of its neighbors when it comes to water. Well, when it comes to other things as well, look what they did with Nepal. And like, you know, their relationship with most of the countries is
bad.
It's only America that seems to love and like India, but the neighbors are they get their doses regularly, and that is why it is sad that, you know, SARC is the way it is. It's like, you know, there and not so there, because
SARC is done. They're not coming to SARC, and so the Afghanistan and Bhutan and Bangladesh.
That's what I'm saying.
They sided with, so SARC seems to be, it has been done. So
it was a toothless tiger to begin with. It never really got off, frankly speaking, because you know,
you
know, these very small countries, and then there was this one country which is personifying itself as a superpower, and then there is this another country which is keeping it at bay. When you know, when you have a situation like this, when you have arch enemies sitting on the table, and you have other countries who then cannot really say that, okay, I'm with this one or I'm with that one, you cannot have a functional system.
Right. So, what is the way forward, you think?
From Kashmiri's point of view?
I'm asking you for a very special purpose. You know, one is Dunti Roy and from Indian mm-hmm. support and all. Second, thing is, you know, one of the judge of the Supreme Court of India, who has been booked for on treason charges this morning, he held a press conference and said that if you want Kashmir, Pakistan want Kashmir, remember, then you will have to take Bihar as well. It's a package. So you just imagine that this Kashmir problem has spilled over.
Yes, it
in
has.
The mainline India, and Bihar is, you know, close to Assam and Nagaland. And
yes, the problem areas of India. But it is also a recognizable fact that it is only the Kashmiris who are brave enough to stand up for their rights and to express that they want Azadi. Nowhere in India are they able to express themselves as the Kashmiris are. Even though we're being killed and maimed and our women are being raped, but still they have been unable to suppress our desire for Azadi or for us to get out and express that desire. Nowhere in India do you see that. A little bit might happen here and a little bit over there. Nagaland has its own small army or something that, you know, they tried to create in their own manner. They want to vent their expression
militant,
and but no one has the kind of traction, no one has the kind of unity that at this point of time Kashmir has, and so people associate with that. The weaker people of India, of course, they associate with Kashmiris who have the guts and the strength to stand up to such a huge country and say that.
And for such a long
cannot,
time.
Yes, 1947 to date is a very long time, and long they don't even scare us anymore.
Yeah. So here we take another break, and after the break we will try to reach some sort of a conclusion which could have been a way forward. So please stay with us.
diverse.
It's original.
It's SDTV.
Welcome back. So what is the solution? What do you think that is the ideal solution right now, and what Pakistan should do, and what with the help of Azad Kashmir?
Pakistan has to keep on telling the international world the actual situation of Kashmir. It does isolate Pakistan a lot, but frankly, Pakistan does not have much of a choice. Pakistan cannot leave Kashmir as it is. That is not possible. If it ever were, someone would have said something and things would have been different. So this is something which is not even thought of, that remove Kashmir from the table. Pakistan will keep on at all and every levels, it will keep Kashmir alive. We, the Kashmiris ourselves, are out on the streets. One thing that I have been asking, and I think it will, even Musharraf Sahab asked for it, and it's been always desired and wished for, is that let the Kashmiris meet each other. Let the Kashmiris meet each other, and let us not have to go through a lot of red tape to be able to go across a fake line that we do not accept. We, the Kashmiris, do not accept these lines that are called LOC, working boundary, whatever you want to call them. That is your line, that is not our line, but it is the Kashmiris. We would like to meet each other. We need to increase our communication. Our interaction needs to increase a lot, and the traction is increasing. The youth are now associated to it. This will only move forward, and this will only increase. This will not decrease.
Do you think there is some third solution to the problem?
I have no idea.
What do you think?
I don't know. I haven't thought like that.
No, you don't. You haven't thought that. Or is there any?
I don't know. What would you think is the third solution?
No, in some sort of, like Punjab was one. It was divided between the two countries.
Kashmiris will decide what they want.
Kashmiri, that's why I'm asking.
Every Kashmiri at this point of time is saying we want Azadi from Hindustan.
Hindustan.
Yes.
So it means that they don't want to leave any territory with them.
I think this then again puts Kashmir into a weird, this is not what is being discussed.
I'm asking you for a very specific, for example, I mean in Ladakh and Jammu, the movement is not as severe as it is in the valley, I mean, for very obvious reason. And in Azad Kashmir, I personally understand, maybe wrong, that if that part of the Kashmir is liberated, Pakistan would not mind giving this part of the Kashmir to the, if it's a separate nation, because it doesn't matter much.
I cannot say much about a free Kashmir, because as at this point of time and to this point of time, what Kashmiris have said is Azadi. You know, if you were following a game plan, a larger plan, that we'll get Azadi and then we'll do this and that, blah blah blah, we would have. Because you see, the thing is that the plebiscite and the resolutions that recognize Kashmir as an issue, the choice that they give is India and Pakistan. Now you're talking about a third solution.
So
I don't.
No third solution.
It could be, but let us reach to that point. How can we start discussing a third solution when the present solutions or so-called discussed
for
solutions
example,
have
for
not
example,
achieved anything?
For example, I mean, it's a hearsay, it's not hearsay, but it's according to the sources, which I have not seen the document. I mean, nobody has seen that document, probably. In the Vajpayee time, what they were discussing, they were prepared to give Pakistan all the territory west of Chenab. That includes Srinagar. That includes Srinagar, Kupwara, Islamabad, Uri, all that area. It means that Chenab is in India, just river passes, but all the west, so most of the valley to this part. So that is where they want Azadi. Because in Ladakh, they are already federally administered. And in Jammu, that doesn't matter. Their demography has been changed over the last 60, 70 years. Through a plan in Jammu, the demography has changed a lot during the last 70 years, especially during the last 30 years, 30-40 years. So that was one plan. And when you look in totality, it was the vein of Kashmir, like Punjab. And when you see the other part, the Niaz Naik thing, and they let the whole valley and all the and Ladakh become India and Gilgit and this become Pakistan, that was the vein of Kashmir.
Yes.
So if they want Azadi, the valley want Azadi, the 80 kilometer long or 40, 50 kilometer wide palm shaped valley that want Azadi. And that is the Kashmir issue. So what do you think that it could be a solution where you can start talking the three parties, the stakeholder, and reach to some solution? Do you think there is some solution?
The formula which is synonymous with Musharraf Saab.
Rest of Chinab.
Yeah. Whatever and however it was, did India actually do something about it? It discussed, but then what happened?
Yeah, at the last moment, that was vetoed by the military bureaucracy.
That's the reality.
So it is not possible.
India, till they are actually ruled by their army, they're not doing anything, so, and they're not going anywhere. So, you know, let's call a spade. India is saying Kashmir is an integral part. I think this weakens our case if we start discussing, you know, this side of Chenab and this side and, you know, this division. And no. At this point of time, we say Kashmir. Yes, of course, because like India says, Kashmir is an integral part. It is not going to discuss any kind of solution because it says that it is not an issue. Kashmir is not an issue for India.
Right.
So for us to, you know, dilute it by like, you know, going moving forward, ignoring this reality that India is not serious. India has never been serious about the human rights abuses. For them, it is a norm. It's not just Kashmir that suffers. There are so many other places
in Punjab
that have suffered and faced.
Janel Singh Bhindranwala.
And it's just not there. I mean, like, you know, it's their caste system. There are so many things that are so negative about India, but the whole world sees it as rising and shining India. What a sad state of affairs to be in. I mean, like, people say Pakistan is this and that, and, you know, Pakistanis themselves put down Pakistan so much. But this very IT tech savvy India has a curfew, not just on the roads, but on the internet as well. Kashmir suffers from internet blackouts. So no matter how you try to present it, the fact is that, you know, Kashmir has always been dealt extremely badly by India. And for them to always say that it is an integral part, well, they have never treated it as an integral part. They have not respected as an integral part. And Kashmiris never accepted them. It is not that they accepted and now they're saying, oh, no, we're reverting, or, you know, we did not make the right decision. Kashmiris never accepted it. Whatever the story of the instrument of accession might be, Kashmiris did not accept it, that they want to join India. Junagarh went through whatever it went through, but you see that did not happen in Kashmir. Kashmiris never accepted it. So it is not that we are going back on our words.
Right.
We always said that we will not.
So if I put it in just one as a one-liner, Kashmir want Azad.
Of course.
Right. So on that slogan, we will come to end of the program. And next time, next program, next topic, next year, please keep watching our program.